We are at 1 o'clock, so we're going to get started with this session. I'd like to welcome everybody back and into our fourth and final session of using PASER and WISLR to manage your roads. As we mentioned in session three, this afternoon we're going to get into using the pavement management tools in WISLR. So you are going to see how to use, to really go beyond just inventorying pavements and entering condition and reporting condition, how you can use these tools to help you map condition, look at backlog of condition, do some trials of five-year budgets. And I'm, of course, Ben Jordan from the Transportation Information Center, and Isaac Park from WISDOT is joining us again. We're back from the morning session and back here with you this afternoon. And so, Isaac, if you could jump to the next slide. What are we going to cover in this session? Well, first of all, the WISLR manual, the last section of the manual, has the material that's covered in this section. We're going to talk about how you get to the pavement analysis tools. We'll go through the functionality of those tools. We'll discuss what information the analysis tools can provide you. We will obviously show how those tools work, what the output looks like from those tools, give you a few tips and tricks on how to use them effectively. And then we'll have a case study at the end where we, in the slides, where we've used data from real data from a community in Wisconsin and run some of these reports with multiple budget trials, just to show you the approach you might take to using the five-year budgeting tool. Next slide, please. Some of the key things to get out of this session is understanding how to identify the magnitude of system need. So you're going to see output that shows backlog work that needs to be done to your system based on the condition ratings that you've reported. You're going to learn how to query the system to give you pavement condition data to help you assess the health of your system, the condition of your system. And as we mentioned, showing you how to create a five-year budget plan, or at least a trial five-year budget plan that you could manipulate further. And you'll see how the WISLR system does its prioritization to come to that five-year plan. So if we could jump to the next slide. And then I think you saw this graph before in an earlier presentation. If you've ever seen a presentation that I've done for TIC about pavements, you've seen graphs like this. This is trying to show a curve of deterioration rate of a pavement, with it starting out in excellent condition and slowly deteriorating initially. And eventually the deterioration accelerates and you get a steeper curve. And you can see on this drawing, between the point where the pavement is new and the inflection point where this curve gets really steep and the condition deterioration is accelerating, there's an opportunity window here where we still have pavement in excellent to good condition, and we can do low-cost maintenance treatments to bring this condition back up and shift this curve over, thereby extending the life of the pavement, as opposed to waiting until we get to the steep part of this curve, doing more expensive treatments. In this example, it says 4 to 5 times the cost, and we may even see more than that late in the life, where we're not going to get as much benefit and we're going to have a higher cost. So WISLR does not take a worse first approach. It's going to give prioritization to these low-cost early maintenance treatments. But there also is a realization that you're going to have to do something at some time with these roads in poor condition. So it also will prioritize by default based on functional classification. But you also have the ability to give some local priority as well. And you will see that in the presentation. And so it's going to look both at the condition, and it's going to look at either that functional class or that prioritization that you've set to also, that's also going to play into the ranking and the decision making on what segments need to have maintenance or rehabilitation first. And you'll see a lot of detail on that as we get further into the presentation. And so at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Isaac, and Isaac's going to run through the functionality of the pavement management tools.
Thank you. I will be covering how to use the pavement analysis tools, but as this is something that many of you have not seen before, feel free to ask questions in chat at any given point in time, and we'll be watching those and addressing those as they come up. So by all means, ask when you're not sure or want to see something or want to go into more detail. So again, like in our first presentation, we are assuming that you already know how to log into pavement analysis. In this screen here, we're showing you kind of what you're going to see anywhere you are whenever you have WISLR open. So at the top of the screen, you have our main menu. And if you're not at the main menu, you can always click on main menu in the top menu. When we open the main menu, you're going to see a list of all the WISLR tools that you have access to. And for the ones that we're seeing today, they are all in this section called pavement analysis in red. You're going to see this menu again once you select your county and your municipality. Every time you open pavement analysis, you will always see this message at the front. And this message is an explanation of how the cost worksheet works. It's letting you know that all of these tools require you to have a cost worksheet set up, which is essentially a mapping from pavement type and rating to how much it costs to perform the maintenance or treatment at that rating. We have, we have a link over here that says default cost worksheet explanation. If you click on this, it gives you an even more detailed explanation of how the cost worksheet works, how it breaks down capital and maintenance expenditures. And also like just a general description of the cost sheet. So everything that we're discussing today, I'll give you a rundown of that. Once you're done reading these notes, you click on continue and it'll open the main module. So if this has loaded for you on your screen, this is the menu that you will see when you open pavement analysis. It's got a lot of options, but it's really broken down into three main parts. So we have these reports at the top, rudimentary needs, and all of these we'll go into more detail as we go along. Rudimentary needs analysis, there are three of them. Then there's a condition frequency report, which is a report that breaks down all of your pavement by PASER rating. And then we have this five-year budget plan at the bottom, which is our tool to help you budget based off of a various number of criteria and settings that you can choose. So the first step that we will have to do at least once in your system is to load your cost data. So if you or anyone in your organization has never done this before, this will be a step that will be required. If someone else in your organization at any point has done it, you will still want to update your cost worksheet, but it's not going to be mandatory to run these reports. So at the bottom of your screen, there's a cost worksheet button that we have circled in red, and clicking on that opens our cost worksheets. And this is what it'll look like when you open it, especially for the first time. So by default, this cost sheet will always open what's saved in your municipality. If no one has ever saved it, it will load WISLR's defaults that we've collected on your screen. So what we have on here is actually our WISLR default. And you can change any of these values to fit what your municipality will see. So as you can see on the left-hand side, the first column, it's our pavement type. So in this row, it's asphalt. And the second column is classification, functional class. And then for each combination of surface type and functional class, we have a rating. And this third, these costs columns, there's one for each functional class and surface type combination at each rating. So as if we take this first line here, rating one, that's saying that for each square yard of asphalt in an urban local road that's rated one, it's going to cost $45 to treat that segment of road per square yard. And the shoulder cost would be $9. This fourth checkbox, capital improvement, that drives whether or not it's going to show up as capital or maintenance. You can't actually check this. We just show it to you so that if you ever need to know which ratings are counted as capital, we're going to list it here too. One thing to note, if you need to ever reload the default costs, like you don't like your costs anymore, there is a second button that says load DOT default costs. And for many of you, if you used our older default costs, those were from 2012 and prices have increased quite a lot. So we recommend if you used our old default costs to use our new ones. Prices have increased between 70 and 115%. So it's the reports are going to change drastically if you update to our new costs from the old ones. So that's something to keep in mind. And if you don't load costs for the first time, you will receive this error message here. And all it's saying is that you need to load costs to your system the way we did before, the way that we just went over. All right. So once we have loaded our costs, we can start running our reports. The first report we're going to go over is rudimentary needs. And these are reports that show you what your ratings are today and what it would cost to treat all of those roads today, given the ratings. These are run based off of an unconstrained budget. So it's pretty much saying if you had all of the money in the world to fix all your roads, here's what it would cost. The way to run it is to select rudimentary needs analysis. So just press the button and then click create report at the bottom. And this is what you will see. You'll see a number of graphs. You'll actually see based off of paved and unpaved, if I remember correctly. Excuse me. So we see here, sorry, this one's not by paved, unpaved. That's a different report. So we see here two sections of graphs. One is for capital and one is for maintenance. So again, this is referring to those pavement ratings. The lower pavement ratings between 1 and 4 are considered capital. These are sections of road that need significant treatment done to the structural integrity of the road. And the second category is maintenance. These are your things like chip sealing, patching, minor things that don't really change the structure of the road. This green column is the cost. So we see for this county, all their capital work will cost them $2,400,000. And next to each cost, there's a second bar that represents the mileage. So that's the white boxes, 8.2 miles. The same works for maintenance, $583,000, and then 17 miles. So we can see already that the capital costs a lot more for a smaller number of miles than the maintenance, which is why we want to do our maintenance work more than capital if we can. On this same screen, we'll see another box here that gives you more information about your roads. This box here is talking about how recently you've rated your roads. So ideally, your ratings need to be 2 years or younger. Your ratings need to be 2 years or more recent for these numbers to actually be accurate. In our example here, 100% of our needs are attributed to one-year-old data. So that's really good. If you have a large number that's greater than 2 years old, your numbers are going to be more inaccurate. So yeah, it's a combination of how accurate your prices are and how accurate your ratings are. That's going to get you a better report for these needs analysis. And on the bottom, we've got one more disclaimer. It's talking again, saying that all of this data is real data. It'll tell you how many miles you have rated and how many miles you have unrated. So any mileage you have that's unrated, it's not going to reflect in these costs. So if you have no ratings or ratings older than 2 years old, it's actually going to make it seem like you have less work than you need to do, because it can't give you an estimate on the prices of those unrated roads. All right, and so, yeah, let's just go again a little bit more detail on what it means to be a capital improvement or a maintenance improvement. A capital improvement is an improvement that will extend the service life of a road, and this is done by really reconstructing or resurfacing the road. It's really improving the integrity of the structure itself. These are the more expensive treatments, as we mentioned earlier. Our maintenance improvements are maintenance actions that preserve our road. They don't really change the structure of the road. They're going to more or less smooth out the time it takes for your road to deteriorate. So these are like your patching, seal coating, and crack sealing. If you do one of these options, it's going to take longer to get to those lower ratings. So that's why we do encourage you to do these maintenance options. All right. And again, this is a tip that we really can't stress enough. Your ratings need to be accurate and they need to be recent. It's a combination of the two. And the report will tell you how you are doing in that respect. All right, so I didn't fit this in the earlier picture just to save some space, but your rudimentary needs analysis does give you three buttons that you can click on: roadway list, show map, and open printable version. And we'll go over what each of these buttons do. If you click on roadway list, it will actually show you how your maintenance and capital costs, your rudimentary needs, will break down based off of each roadway. So we see here our costs, and we can see how much of our maintenance costs and how much of our capital costs come from just this one road, Bass Lake Court. So that's $8,000 of capital out of the total 431,000 in this list here. Show map gives you the same breakdown of maintenance and capital, but it's going to highlight each of your roads based off of which treatment type they need. So this will give you a visual view of where your maintenance tasks are, where your capital needs are. In our legend, we have yellow as maintenance and green as capital. And finally, open a printable version will give you the same rudimentary needs report, but just fit to an 8.5 inch by 11 piece of paper that you can print out on your printer. Okay. So that first rudimentary needs type is our primary version of that report, but we also have two additional views of that report that will cut up your data a little bit differently based on what you want to look at. So the first variant that we are looking at is our rudimentary needs analysis by pavement type. And what this report will do is it will show you the same capital and maintenance costs, but it'll organize your data by the pavement type. So click on the button and then click on, create report. And once you open your report, this is what it's going to look like. So kind of similar, but just a little bit different. The very first part is our rudimentary needs by pavement type. You're going to see all of your pavement types. So in the bar graph, we've got our number, our two-digit codes for each pavement type, And then we have our legend that will tell you what each of these numbers maps to. So for most larger towns, most of it is going to be in this 70 or hot mix asphalt, but you might see some unpaved types or gravel and concrete as well. So that's for capital improvement. And each graph, there will have a second graph underneath that shows the same information by miles. So in our original report, we had the two bars next to each other, but since this report's a little bit bigger, we split it up into two. And again, we see our number 70 hot mix asphalt, most of our miles as well. Okay, and since last time we had both capital and maintenance, that same report, this report will also give you the maintenance broken up by cost and mileage as well. Very similar. And here's our mileage. And we show the same option to show your map and open your printable version. And the same messages that just tell you how much of your miles are rated. Now, if we open our map, you will see all of the information that's shown in that graph, but broken down by roads. So one thing to notice on the top right, our legend says it's by pavement type maintenance. So if you clicked on the show map button for the maintenance treatments, you'll get the maintenance roads. And there's another button for capital if you need to see the same map for capital. But they are split up into two different maps, just like the report is split up. All right. So we had pavement type as one breakdown. Our second breakdown that we provide is by functional class. So like the other reports, you just click on the radio button, and then you click create report. Here we have a little less going on, so we can show it all in one screen what will happen when you click on that report. We're going to have maintenance cost and maintenance miles. And we see for this municipality, almost all of their roads are rural local. And this is kind of what you would expect for most places. There'll be one category, mostly predominant, then maybe just a couple in a different functional class. So this is our maintenance cost in miles. And then we have the same for our capital cost in miles. Again, this county municipalities, all rural local. There will be a map view that will let you see your maintenance or your capital costs broken down by road again. And we see again, it's color coded by the same functional classes that the graphs before were broken up into. And this municipality, it's all pink, all urban local, just like we saw in the graphs. All right, looks like we've got one question in chat. Kathy has asked, we have urban local, urban collector, rural local, and rural collector. What is the difference between local and collector? So Yeah, it's not a classification that you set. It's something that Wisconsin DOT will usually set. But the collector roads are, I would consider them more like medium large roads, if you want to say arterials, like your major roads. They're really roads that are meant to collect traffic from all your little local roads into one bigger road. So can't think of a, I'm just drawing a blank on what you would call that kind of road. It's not quite a major road. It's kind of like a road where a lot of smaller local roads will route into. All right. We don't have any other questions. I will just, looks like we've got another. So as a follow-up, a town road that moves traffic from one county road to another road.
Isaac, I'll jump in here a little bit. So the functional classification that is going to be in here is the WISDOT functional classification, which really comes from the Federal Highway Administration functional classification system. And if you are interested in finding out more detail about that, WISDOT does have a page on their site for functional classification. So if you Google functional classification WISDOT, it does have links to their functional classification maps for rural areas and for urban areas. And depending on kind of where we're at the end of the session, time-wise, I might be able to show that to you if we have a few minutes at the end.
All right. So we covered our rudimentary needs report. The next major report type that we're going to go over is condition frequency. And this report is meant to show you information about the actual ratings and conditions of your pavement. So we'll go over how to use the report, and it's a little more customizable. So we'll show you how to customize that as well. Like with the other reports, you just click on the button next to condition frequency, and then you click create report. It looks like we got a couple more questions. Oh, that's Shelly sending some links in chat. All right. So condition report. Frequency report. So this is just showing you how the report would look like if you don't change anything. So just the default rating ranges. We see here it's broken up by paved and unpaved. So paved is your concrete and your asphalt. Unpaved is everything else. and then it's broken up by rating ranges. So we have 1 to 2, 3 to 4, 5 to 6, 7, 8, and 9 and 10. And unrating is 1 to 5, so we actually just show one bar for each rating. And what it's trying to do is it's trying to show you what percentage of your roads falls into each range. So it kind of loosely maps to failed, poor, good, and excellent. We can actually change what each bar represents, and we will go over that. And again, this is based on actual data. So it relies on your ratings. They need to be up to date and they need to be accurate for it to work. This report here, it's kind of showing you that you've got 34.81 plus 5, so about 40% of your roads are in good condition. And then the other 70 need some sort of maintenance or reconstruction. Like with the other section reports, we have that show map button. And what it will do is it will map all of your local roads into the categories that you have set. So 1 to 2, 3 to 4 is yellow, blue is 5 to 6, gray is 7 to 8, and green is 9 to 10. So this is what we're kind of mentioning earlier in our last presentation when people were asking how you can map your pavement ratings to your PASER ratings or your PASER ratings on a map. This is kind of the easiest way to get a map. It will just automatically do it with one click. There are other ways to map that if people want to know, we can kind of, if we have time, we can do a demo. And also, if you have more extensive needs for mapping, like if you have GIS capabilities, that's something you might want to reach out to WISDOT for. But the map from condition frequency report, this will just be a one-click button that does all this breakdown for you immediately. All right, so we talked about how to just run it from the defaults that we give you, but there's actually a lot of flexibility that you can incorporate into the report yourself if you need to do something different. So we're gonna go over how to customize this report. On the settings, we have paved and unpaved, two columns. And each column is broken down into what we call series. And each series or row corresponds to one of the bar graphs that will appear on the report. So if we wanted to do something different, we can do something like changing one bar graph to represent ratings between 1 and 3, the second being 4 to 6, the third being 7 to 10. You always have to have a min and a max. So if you want only one bar, one rating, so one bar for just all the ones, you would have to put 1 to 1. If you put nothing in there, it will just not create a bar for that. So that's fine. You don't need to have 5. And this is what it looks like when you run it. So now you can see, we now have only 3 bars. One for our 1 to 3, the second for our 4 to 6, and the last for our 7 to 10. So this can be helpful if you actually don't want to see too much granulation. We see a little bit less, some of our ratings clumped into smaller numbers. So if you want a bigger picture view, you can see, it's a little easier to see that 61% of your roads are in pretty good condition. You don't have to do the mental math to group all of that together. And the same for the lower ends. All right, so this is gonna help us with our examples as we go along. This is just a refresher. What we're doing to estimate costs is we're taking the pavement ratings and then we're mapping that to actions, maintenance actions. So for example, rating one and rating two, we consider needing a reconstruct. So we will apply our costs for reconstruction to those ratings. And the same for mill and overlay, resurfacing and crack sealing. So in our example that we're gonna do, we're actually gonna try to break up our report into one bar for each type of maintenance action. And we'll show you how to do that. So now we've got this set of series, 1 to 2 in our first row. So this is gonna be our reconstructs. And then 3 to 3. So that's like our mill and overlay resurfacing. Then 4 to 4, crack sealing. And then, seal coating. Sorry, I accidentally clicked there. And then 5 to 6, it was our seal coat. And 7 to 7, which is just minor crack sealing. And then after we run our report, we've got it broken down into five bars here. So again, doing it like this would allow us to say, we want one bar for each type of maintenance or capital activity. So how you might want to select this, these numbers, it's really up to you. You can customize it based off of what you're trying to analyze and what types of road work you're trying to consider. So for example, if you're not even wanting to consider like reconstruction, for example, you can just exclude that bar completely. If you only wanted to look at, say, seal coat and crack seal activities, you can kind of break down like that. Notice that if you look at how you sum this up, this isn't going to add up to 100%. And that's because we remove the 8 to 10s in our series. It's showing you that about 45% of this municipality's road needs some sort of maintenance action. And of that 45%, about 15, the left half, is capital, and about 30% is our maintenance. So you can kind of deduce that 55% of your roads are between 8 and 10. They don't have any maintenance or capital need. All right. And finally, the most exciting part of our pavement analysis is our budget plan. So we have this option for create a new five-year budget plan. When you click on this button, you're going to need to put a budget for each of these 5 years. So each cell represents the budget for that year. If you don't want to put a budget, you still have to put a number greater than zero. So one is the smallest number you would put if you just don't, if you want to just say that you didn't get any budget for that year. And in our example, we're going to show you how to create a budget with $400,000 every year. All right. So after we run it, it's going to give you a lot of information, and we're going to zoom in. So don't worry about seeing all of this all at once. It's broken up into several sections, though. At the very top is going to show you what settings we ran our report under. And you're going to see the budget for each year. So there's our 400,000. And underneath the budget, you're going to see our expenditure. So how much the tool is saying you should spend in that year. So in our example, we have 170,000 for the first year and 600,000 for our second year. And you can see that it's also kind of like carrying over money from year to year. It's saying that you don't have enough money in the first year to actually finish projects for all of the projects that you want to start. So it's going to save some of that money and then spend it the second year when you actually have access to that. So that's what's going on there. That's why it's spending more than 400,000 on the second year. And underneath this, the main part of our report is this table. And it's going to just give you a breakdown sorted by year. So these are all of your first year projects. And then within each year, it's sorted alphabetically by your road. So we see it started from RBAC and it's going down the A's. At the bottom of the report is a graph of your conditions and your expenditures. So it's showing you what your conditions look like when you first started. So this is 0-0. And it's going to show you that what your conditions are going to be after you do your road improvements. So we're going to go into more detail about how this works, but it not only incorporates what treatment that you've done to your roads. So we see here that a lot of our numbers are 70 or 7 to 8s have increased a lot, but it's also going to take into the fact that some of your roads are going to go down a rank. Like it's going to go from 5 to 6 to 4 to 3 to 4 over 5 years. So it's going to take that into account too. This last graph here, the third graph, it's going to show you how much need you had before you ran the report. So that's the first column. The second column is how much money you spent. So 1.4 million in our case here. And then the third column is going to show you how much still needs work after your five-year plan. So let's zoom in on our five-year budget. Whoops. So again, at the top is our budget and our expenditures. There's our some options for storing and reloading your forecast. So that's our second row. Our third row is a row of buttons for sorting, as well as mapping. And then our table underneath goes over the actual budget. And then this is a close-up look at our conditions. So again, we see our conditions before our plan in our first column here. So it looks very similar to our condition frequency report, actually. Here's our conditions after our plan in the second column. And you can see that our numbers are changing in between. More of our roads are fair and above, and more of our roads are good to excellent. And then our third column shows our backlog, how much our backlog has reduced. So in our first 00, we had 13 million in needs. And after our $5 million of expenditures, our needs have gone down to about 8.3 million. Looks like we have a question from Highway Brand. If seal coats are such a good maintenance activity, why doesn't DOT do them on their system? Yeah, I think we're not quite the group to ask this question to. Sorry about that, but we'll move on from that. All right. So moving along, there is a printable summary version, which will give you all of this information, the graphs and our budget, into one printable sheet of paper. So it's the same information that we showed you in the page, but just put in a format that you can print onto a piece of paper. So the first section is our budget and expenditures. And the second is that section of graphs at the bottom of our report. Now to go on to these sorting functions, this was that third row of buttons. And then we see that you can sort by year. And there are five buttons. Sorry, it's kind of confusing here. I tried to zoom in case it's hard to see. So this is what the sort by year buttons look like. It's just five buttons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So say you press button 2 for the second year. What it's gonna do is it's gonna jump to the page on your table that has the first instance of your second year. So we see that it, in our example, we're gonna jump to page 6, I believe. There's gonna be a row of number buttons as well, first, previous, and these number buttons that you can use to just click through the pages individually. Finally, there's a backlog button, and this might not be totally obvious when you first click on it, what it does. What it does is it jumps to the section of your report that have roads that don't get any treatment. So there wasn't enough budget to get to them, or they were roads that didn't need treatment. So you might see numbers already there. That's actually going to show you the very end of the year 5 and before, as well as backlog. So that's what's going on there. So again, these backlog are any roads that didn't have any action done to them. Either they don't need action, their priority was too low to compete with the other roads that did get budget allocated to them, or if there's no rating data for that section, our system isn't gonna know what to do with those roads. So it's gonna just put them in the backlog. Data mismatches or problems with the data are treated the same as roads without any data. So you want to make sure again that the data is correct and appropriate. And here's just a screenshot of backlog. And again, you're gonna see a lot of roads that don't have action. And that's what the backlog button does. It's not a bug. It's just saying the system couldn't do anything to them in that 5-year plan. Okay. So there is a map function in the 5-year tool, and it's going to map by the project type. So in our example here, we have crack sealing, no action, and seal coat in our legend. And we're just going to highlight all of your roads that fall into those categories. So in this particular slice, we see a lot of black, which is our no action. I think if we zoomed a little bit closer, those other actions, the seal coats, will show up. It's a little hard to tell in this map because the orange map blends in with the highways, which is a little unfortunate. But it's pretty straightforward. It works exactly the same as our other maps. And finally, we have print and download spreadsheet. And what that does is it takes your entire five-year budget plan and puts it into Excel. So you'll be able to see each road segment, what year the treatment will happen, what treatment we're suggesting, how much it's gonna cost for each year. So we'll show you some pictures of that spreadsheet as well. If we zoom in to our spreadsheet, this is what it's gonna look like. You're gonna see all of your roads, your pavement ratings, and then the treatment. At the bottom, you're gonna see tabs, and it's gonna break it down by your year and your backlog. Project's not in five-year plan, that's your backlog. So it's not gonna be just one big sheet, it's gonna break it down by year for you. All right, so there's a little bit of customization that you can do. Once you have the fiber plan, that's gonna be what our tool calculates for you automatically. But you can actually edit that plan a little bit more to see what's gonna happen if you change things around a little bit. The way to do that is to press edit on the right-hand side of that road that you wanna change. And it's gonna make all of these columns, so year one, through five, your local ID, and your PMPC. So this is your priority classification. And it's gonna let you edit it. So for example, we have crack sealing as our activity in year one. You can either change that to a different activity, or you can change that to no, and then add your crack sealing to another year. You can also edit the costs. So you can enter a user cost at the bottom that will let you put a different cost. So say you already have an estimate or you know how to estimate and you think it's different than what WISLR is estimating, you can change that yourself. And then it will update your budget and expenditures accordingly based off of what you put in there. If you don't change it and you just change the action, it will automatically calculate what WISLR thinks that action costs for that road segment. So again, here we are trying to edit, and it's just showing you what it's going to look like. So in our screenshot here, we clicked on our action. So it creates this drop-down box, and it lets you select any of our actions for that pavement type. So we see crack sealing, single seal coat, resurfacing, mill and overlay. And this list is going to change based off of your pavement type. So if you have gravel road, it's going to give you only the gravel type actions, and concrete is going to give you a different set of actions as well that's tailored for concrete. Okay, just a few more notes here that we couldn't fit into the screenshot, but you're going to see an action for every year. You can change any of these actions, and clicking on any of the menus will let you see the dropdown. And then you can move things from year to year. So you can say you want to do this year one project in year three instead, for example. You can change the type of action, you can change the cost, and you can change the PMPC, pavement management priority class. And you can add a local ID if you want to change your local ID in your report. So put a name or label to your segment of road. Now, what you might want to do is save your reports And we're going to go over this in our case studies. But oftentimes, you're going to want to compare different types of budgets. So different amounts, different yearly amounts, and compare them side by side. And saving lets you save all your reports that you run and then just load those. It'll save you some time. You won't have to re-enter your budget amounts. And it will just give you a snapshot of this whole five-year budget that's computed for you. So the way that's done is to go into the second row for stored forecasts, that's circled in red. And then you're going to put a name and description for your report. So everybody in your municipality will be able to see your saved reports. You're going to want to make sure that your report is original. It doesn't overlap with someone else's name. And just give a description so other people can know what that report is, who ran it or why it's run, what that report was doing. On the right-hand side, you've got save this forecast, and that will just save your report. And you'll get a confirmation at the upper left saying that your changes were saved, circled in red. This reload save button, it will let you reload your report. So if you made some changes and you want to undo them, you can reload the save if you had it saved before. All right, so continuing along, now that we've saved the report, we're going back to the main menu in this screenshot to show you how to load it. There's a button at the bottom that says Browse Saved Forecasts. And when you click on that, it will actually give you a list of all your saved reports shown on the right here. So in our example, we have one saved report. And it's going to give you the name and the description. And if you click on the name, it will open exactly what you had saved. This delete button at the right-hand side, that will delete your report. So if you don't need it anymore, you can get it out of your list like that. They are sorted oldest to newest. Okay, so this slide can look a little bit scary, but it's not that bad. It's just some math that's explaining what's going on with our priority, how it chooses what to do in the first year before the second year. The way it works is that each road is given a priority score based off of how important that road is, how much usage is there, and the current rating. So I say current because the five-year tool is actively taking deterioration into account. So your 7 in year 1 might become a 6 in year 5, and that will recompute the priority for each year, given that deterioration. So what does it mean for importance? What it's actually taking is your functional class and giving it a name, either major, minor, or local. So most majors are your arterial roads and minors are your collectors. And everything else maps between local and low use. So that's your, local. It's also taking into account urban and rural classification as well. That's why it's not a straight up just arterial collector local. So majors have a score of 100, low use has a score of 20. And then you've got our ratings mapped to a MAT rank. And then it does a computation where you're dividing your importance by your rank. So we'll go over an example. It'll be easier if we show you what's going on there. But after this calculation, you'll get your priority scale from a scale of 1 to 100. So let's just take an example. We have a major road, and let's say it's our asphalt, and a PASER rank of 7. This is going to give it a priority scale of 100. If we take a same major road, but with a PASER rating of 2, that same computation is going to give you a 44.44. So this is how we're showing you that we're prioritizing maintenance on better condition roads that have more cost-effective maintenance options over our, the same roads that have a lower ranking, lower PASER rating that would require more costly capital improvements. So in our same example, so we had major as 7, rating 7 with 100 as our priority. If we took a local road with the same PASER rating, it's given a priority scale of 49.9. So we're seeing that even if it's the same pavement type, same PASER rating, we're giving more priority to the road that's used more over the road that's used less, which is what our local road is. And we see at the bottom, our low uses, they're actually all at the bottom. So anything that's low use, they're gonna be prioritized last over anything that's local or higher. The same calculation is done for seal coat and gravel, but we see here that our unpaved roads or seal coat, for example, it's actually starting at a priority of 80. So we're kind of already giving it less priority than our paved roads, which start at 100. So I guess it's a little more mathy than a lot of people need, but it's just kind of showing you how we do have a system that's kind of adjusting itself based off of how big, how used your road is and what kind of road it is and how much it will cost to fix it. Seems like a good time to check for questions. So Josh has a question. Any plans to account for rejuvenators, reclaimite, and how they delay the need for crack filling?
Isaac, do you want me to touch on that? So the question was about like reclaimite, GSB 88, or both rejuvenators or other rejuvenators out there, fog seals. Those would typically be applications that would be applied at a PASER rating, let's say, of 8. WISLR does not accommodate that at this point. I've got a wish list for the future. And whenever we meet and talk about WISLR, I always make sure I mention my wish list. And that's on the wish list. Currently you cannot model that in the pavement analysis tools in WISLR. I still encourage you to do it. It is still going to, if you have the budget to do it and you're able to be aggressive and proactive on maintenance, what it is still going to do is it's going to slow the progression of the deterioration of that pavement. And so it will take you longer to drop down to the next lower rating number, because you're going to see aging distresses slow down. You're going to see that aging cracking not appear as quickly. And so it's valuable. It's going to be hard to model the value of it in the way this is currently set up, because it does not allow you to show a maintenance activity on a rating of 8.
Thank you. And Kathy has a question. How did you get to that PMPC report? I think if you're referring to this yellow tables that you see here, you can find these in the PASER manual. So if you are not PASER manual, the WISLR manual. So if you open the manual now, it should be in that section for pavement analysis in the 5-year plan. And actually a lot of the pictures that you see here, including the formula that you saw in the previous slide, that's gonna be in the manual as well.
And this table is really kind of the prioritization engine that's working in the background of WISLR to make those decisions for your 5-year plan recommendations when you put a budget in. And so this prioritization is the same is run behind every plan for every agency. It's not like a customizable plan. It's not like it's, you know, a different set of tables for different types of agencies. This is taking into account everything. And this is the prioritization scheme, the scoring mechanism that's being used to decide which roads get higher priority and lower priority. So it's good for you to have in your back pocket to understand what's happening behind the scenes. So it's not a black box where you're putting information in and you're getting this out from WISLR and you say, I don't know how it decided to pick this road over that road. This is basically the decision tool, the rating tool that gets to that priority. So it's not like you're gonna see a way to print this report out, you know, for your community within WISLR, but you are gonna see, as you saw, you do see some of that priority score information on the output when you get that five-year plan.
All right, one last graph for your enjoyment. This is our deterioration curve. So this is a visualization of what WISLR is doing to your pavement report ratings in the background when it's calculating your five-year budget plan. Each line represents one type of pavement. So we see her at the top at the 10s. These are all of our paved types, asphalt and concrete. And then below is our unpaved. And it's got a little bit of a curve here that changes its steepness as time goes on. So what it's saying is in the background, the system knows how old your pavement is. So it's going to know that, say, you have a 25-year-old piece of pavement here. And then at the end of the 5 years, it's going to say that your pavement is actually this rating. So it's going to see that it's went from somewhere between a 5 and a 6 down to a 5. So that's what's going in the background. And you can see, like, it's a little bit smooth. It like smooths out before it gets steep. So you want to ideally do your maintenance before it starts dropping really fast in condition. And with that, we have some case studies. I can hand it over to Ben.
And if you could double check, if there's one question in the chat box, well, I'll take over control of the screen. And if you could look at that one while I'm doing that, I'd appreciate it.
Okay, sorry, you see a question?
Is the five-year plan required?
Okay, I think it's might be lagging on mine. No, the five-year plan is optional. It's really a tool for you to use and help you with your management.
Yeah, and I think we're about to see if I can talk and navigate at the same time. Let's see here. Let me stop sharing.
Want me to stop sharing here?
Yeah. Part of the reason we're doing this training and part of the reason we're trying to get you all up to speed on this is we really encourage the use of the plan because, you know, this is a tool that's out there free of charge. You're already putting all the data into the system to, you know, tell DOT what the condition of your roads are. I'll do a very quick review of the first 50 slides here. These tools are there and it costs nothing to use them. They're relatively easy to use and it can give you some information that can help you in your decision-making. If you're not doing this, you're probably have a spreadsheet just with a list, just an inventory of pavements. Or maybe you have a list with kind of a calendar frequency of maintenance. You say, well, it's been 7 years since we did a chip seal on that road. Maybe it's time for us to do another one on it or something like that. You know, some agencies have kind of a they have that kind of a setup where they're doing some things based on a calendar basis. So here you're doing things based on what the condition is now, or we're projecting the budget, what the condition is now, and based on that average deterioration curve that Isaac just showed you, which we'll get to again here. Very sorry that we're going back through all of this. There we go. Based on this deterioration curve, the system is projecting where you're going to be in 5 years with each of those segments, and it's giving you information on your system overall based on that. And so I'm not aware of too many agencies in the state that have capabilities to do that outside of this system, to do those projections. There may be some larger agencies. I know I've talked to a couple of counties who were working on developing some specific deterioration curves for their county or for some local agencies within their county. But for the most part, those are tools that we don't have. And so this is free tool. You're already accessing it to report information, and it can really help you do some what-if scenarios and help you with your decision-making on your roads. So no, is it required? Do you have to run a five-year plan and submit it? No, but it's a tool that can help you locally in your decision-making. Comments that I wanted to make before I jump too far into the analysis. Actually, no, I'll make the comments here. So we're going to go through a scenario, kind of a case study. We're using data in this case study from Shawnee, Wisconsin, and I gathered a little bit of information about what they typically do for maintenance, or at least what they've done the last couple of years. But really, to start out, when you're thinking about running these five-year plans, some of this is a repeat of things Isaac has said. Make sure your pavement condition ratings are up to date. If you have out-of-date information, that's going to give you a less accurate picture of where your condition is going to be in 5 years. Make sure inventory data is correct. Centerline link segments, you want to make sure your centerline mileage is correct for your annual mileage certification, because that's one of the inputs that goes into GTA calculations. And for towns, that's almost always the controlling input on what your GTA is going to be. You want to know what your pavement width is and have that pretty accurate, because when we're talking about the costs in WISLR, you saw square yard costs. What those square yard costs are trying to do is capture all of the costs associated with that maintenance treatment or that reconstruction improvement, and taking that total cost and dividing it by the number of square yards of pavement that are shown for that segment in WISLR. And when you saw shoulder data in the cost table that Isaac showed you earlier, that's not the cost of the shoulder divided by the square yards of shoulder. That's the cost associated with shoulder divided by the square yards of pavement in WISLR. So the square yards in WISLR are going to be width times length divided by 9, basically. And so it's important that that width and that length for the segments is correct, and that you have all the segments in there. And so you want to make sure that is accurate. You might want to look at pavement segments and think about adjusting starting and endpoints to match how you would construct segments in reality. If you have kind of default segments that historically came from, the beginning of WISLR and were loaded in and they're broken down from center of intersection to center of intersection, typically you don't start a maintenance project or a construction project in the middle of an intersection, and you don't end the project in the middle of an intersection. So if you want those five-year plans to kind of follow the way you do things, you could go back in and look at adjusting, some of those offsets, adjusting those start and end points of segments. This says update building costs to WISLR current estimated costs for maintenance and rehabilitation treatments. I'm really excited that working with Isaac and working with Jeff Gust and working with others at WISDOT, we've updated the default costs in WISLR. So that was done through a combination of looking at the old costs and applying a construction cost index, kind of like a consumer price index to those costs. Then separately, we gathered some data from local road improvement projects and looked at cost per square yard there. I went out and pulled data from some local websites, bid tabulations from some of the commercial sites that local agencies are now using to post their bid documents for bid and post their bid results. So we gathered cost data from different sources. We tried to compare those. We did some kind of expert task kind of approach where we used our experience also to kind of inform that. And we came up with some new default cost numbers. Now, your numbers locally might be a little bit different than that because you may be closer or further from a supplier than kind of an average cost that we put in. You may be doing a somewhat different treatment. You may have a thinner or thicker layer of asphalt that you would be putting in. So if you do have good local costs, it still may be a good idea to update those lines where it's the type of road you have. So if you only have rural local roads, you might only just need to go in and update the cost for the lines associated with rural local. But for every classification you have and type in terms of rural or urban, go in and update those costs where you have your own cost data. And you can get your own cost data by looking at recent projects, looking at the total cost of those projects, and for each of those projects, divide the total cost by the square yards of pavement that are in that project. And so total cost of the project, not just the pavement items, total cost of the project, including things like, work zone traffic control, putting down new striping if you have striping, whatever it is that's associated with that. Except for underground utilities that would be charged elsewhere. We didn't include sidewalks in the default costs. But whatever you have locally that should be included in those costs, you divide it by the square yards of pavement, and that gives you a cost per square yard factor that's going to get applied. And so you can consider updating those yourselves. Isaac also showed you in the output the pavement maintenance priority classifications. And those are going to default based on the WISDOT functional classification, but you can change those. And so that can be useful in making the five-year plan even more valuable to you if you can identify certain roads that are higher priority and make those a higher priority in the classification system. That will then adjust how WISLR scores, as we saw in the table that we just passed a couple slides ago, how it scores that segment when it's making decisions about the plan. So you've seen this report, you've seen the, how to get to the cost worksheet. And again, think about if you have local costs, think about updating those, even though the default costs should be quite useful now because the default costs have been updated. And with this data for Shauna, we're going to go through kind of looking at some of the reports that we already talked about. And so you see rudimentary needs analysis, condition frequency of report. You notice even in what Isaac went through, we skipped over the average rating by pavement type, average rating by functional class, in part because, again, I said I don't find those that useful. I don't find them that meaningful. I definitely would discourage you from figuring out what your average rating is and asking other communities what their average rating is and comparing yourself, because we're all different. We all have different roads. They're different ages. They have different soils underneath. They have different traffic. And so, there's limited useful information you get out of the averages. So this is the cost entry screen again, and we talked about that once already. Again, you would go in, and if you were looking at the total cost of your project, your local project, and you wanted to get square yard costs, your items related to pavement, you divide those, the cost of total of those items divided by the square yards of pavement. Items related to shoulder in an urban area, that could be your curb and gutter. Divide that by the total number of square yards of pavement to get a shoulder cost. So if you wanted to update those would be the approaches to take. But take a look at the default cost. You may find those to be pretty reasonable and up to date for your purposes. I think I'm not quite where I want to be. What happened here? I'm sorry, So we kind of, this is really kind of reviewing everything that we did before. So you've gone through, we've talked about, sorry about that. We've talked about rudimentary needs. We've talked about condition frequency. We've shown you how you can customize that. This is the basic output of it. This is the five-year budget. It's a good idea to run multiple trials of the budget to see impacts, and we're going to do that for this case study. You saw these two charts earlier. This is just the paved roads pulled out of that. And again, if you adjust the priority class for a road in your system, it's going to shift it in this prioritization. So if you had something that was local, but it's an important road for you in your particular community and you increase its class, it's going to jump it up on the priority system that's occurring behind the scenes in WISLR. The local pavement road pavement deterioration curves that are going on in the background in WISLR. Isaac talked about how those are projecting the condition of your pavement in 5 years. Understand that these are statewide average data that was collected a number of years ago when WISLR was put together. It is averaging county roads, city streets, town roads that fit into the same pavement surface category. And so you may have roads that in reality function differently than this, that deteriorate more quickly, deteriorate more slowly. Another thing that's interesting to note about this particular graph is the kind of classic theoretical pavement curve, supposed to start out pretty flat and horizontal, not much deterioration. You see that on the average, looking at the statewide data when this was put together, there was some early deterioration. So we see more of a slope on this line. And as Isaac pointed out, we see kind of flattening of it toward the middle of the life. And so that also argues again for some of the things like the discussion of doing things like a fog seal or a rejuvenator on a pavement rated an 8. Trying to do some things early in the life to slow this deterioration makes some sense. Another thing interesting about this graph is for most of the paved surfaces, we cross the pavement rating of 4, which is a trigger to do, as Isaac said, capital or basically structural improvement of the pavement. We're crossing that somewhere in the 35-year range pretty consistently on those. And so that's an interesting thing to note about that graph. We've talked about how you can download spreadsheets. I find the spreadsheet to be a little easier to look at than the output on the screen. And so this is, again, just the example of the spreadsheet output. So getting to the City of Shawano case study, they primarily have paved roads. There's, you know, a third of a mile of unpaved. They were rated in 2022, at least at the time that we ran this this simulation. Community of population in 2020 of a little over 9,000 people. It's the county seat of Shawano County. As we mentioned, WISLR default costs have been updated in 2023. I pulled a little bit of Shawano bid data from 2022 and 2023. I didn't have the square yards available on all of those projects, so there were some where I couldn't really convert those to a cost per square yard. Again, if you can come up with good local costs that are more representative of, if you have enough projects, you can get representative local costs, go ahead and use those. But if you don't have them, use the default costs. If you have feedback for us on the default costs, because we just did update them this year, we certainly would be interested in that feedback as well. The local costs are going to be best estimated using actual costs from comparable treatments, recent projects, either at your agency or nearby agencies. So you could share information with other towns around you, with other cities, villages around you, nearby counties, whoever is in your same geographic area going to have similar costs of having the contractor mobilize and bring in materials so that the costs are somewhat reflective of your local conditions. Remember that, you know, the PACER ratings are directing you to treatment recommendations. It's not the other way around. So rate based on the distresses you see, rate accurately based on the distresses, that's going to give you a better output from your five-year plan. So this was some data we pulled from bid tabulations from Shawano for the last couple of years. When I did this, I did not use as high a number as this for kind of our base case budget, because the interesting thing about the last couple of years is, you know, there's been some additional money available to locals for projects between bipartisan infrastructure law and some of the special funding that was available from the pandemic. And so I picked a somewhat lower number for us to use as a base case. We picked $500,000 to use as a base case. And then we're going to compare. We did a number of runs with different budgets to see what the impact was for the system. So the first thing we did was we ran the rudimentary needs. And I'm just showing you the paved because there was only a third of a mile of unpaved. And you saw these same reports when Isaac went through them earlier, how to get them out of WISLR. And so they're showing about $4 million in capital needs. And again, this is unconstrained. This is all of the needs for the whole system, not what you're trying to accomplish in 5 years. $4 million in capital, $800,000 in maintenance. And again, you got a little over 8 miles of capital, a little over 17 miles of maintenance. For their purposes, we took the condition frequency report and we split it up in a more customized way. They would do a similar treatment on 1 to 3. They may do a different treatment rather than fully reconstructing the road on a 4. They might do an over pulverize and over relay overlay. 5 to 6s are going to tend to be surface treatments. You know, 7s are typically going to be things that we talk about crack sealing. As we talked about 8 through 10, when you look at what's going on in WISLR, you really don't have the opportunity to apply a treatment to those. So, you know, if you thought about this as crack seal in 7, surface treatment in 5 to 6, overlay or perhaps a pulverizing overlay, and these are city streets, so sometimes with reconstruction 1 to 3, they would be doing underground utility replacement as well. And so at least in this condition frequency report, you can customize it to match up with how you do things in your community. Here you have that condition frequency that we just looked at mapped to their system. We're zoomed in a little closer so you can see that map. And so the red is 1 to 3s, the yellow is 4s. So the yellow and the red are going to be ones that, you know, need structural improvement, need reconstruction, or need additional thickness of asphalt. 5s and 6s are kind of the bluish purple color, so those would be surface treatment candidates. 7s are gray, crack seal candidates. The green are 8 to 10. So one of the things you see visually from this system is that their system starting out right now is in pretty good shape. Probably not going to see as much green on a lot of systems if you run these reports. And again, there's that same condition frequency graph you saw 2 slides ago. And I've kind of talked about, you know, we grouped it this way because 1 to 3 would be rehab strategies, 4 overlay, 5 to 6 surface treatment, 7 crack seal, 8 to 10 no action. So at least in this initial condition frequency report, you can customize that for your local needs. So what we're going to do in this scenario and what I'd suggest as an approach for you is start out with what your normal budget is. Look what you were able to spend last year, the year before. And if they're significantly different, maybe average them out. Maybe put a little inflation factor into it if you're going to be able to budget a little more. But some kind of budget that's what you've already planned or expected, or you think reasonably, you know, you as a town board, or you as an, you know, would approve, or you as an engineer could bring to your council and get them to approve, you know, something that's kind of a base case that's a little bit of the status quo, doing what we have been doing. Then we're also going to do a do nothing budget. And Isaac told you that, you know, WISLR doesn't like zeros in those fields for the 5 years of the 5-year budget plan. So you put a dollar in each year. And what you're going to find is there are no projects that you can do for a dollar. So it's going to give you an output that doesn't have any projects in it because you didn't give it any budget to work with. And then just to understand impacts, let's, in addition to doing that, do nothing budget, which is we're not going to do anything at all any year for 5 years, run a reduced budget, maybe 25 to 50% less than your planned or expected budget. And then one that's an increase. So what's something we could do that maybe might be within our reach, within our financial capabilities now, or if there is, you know, some revenue source we could look at increasing somewhat reasonably, we could get to this bigger number, and then run the 5-year plan for each of these options. So we're going to run that preliminary proposed budget for each of these. We might, you know, once we get all of these and decide what one's reasonable, we might edit to include some of the local adjustments for the first 2 years, moving some projects around. Isaac talked about ways you can do that. And, you know, look at this for reasonableness. Does it make sense to you locally? Consider trying that importance feature to change the priority of some of those streets. So this was the do nothing plan. And again, I'm not using this as my base case, but I wanted to show you this first because this could help us to kind of understand where we're at and understand some of the impacts. So we started out with, again, a system that's in pretty good condition. We've got 37% in 7 to 8, 31% in 9 to 10. So we've got, you know, 2/3 of our system that are 7 or better. And we have relatively small amount in the 1 to 2. Only 2% of our system is in the 1 to 2 rating. You can see with the do nothing, we're going to increase the 1 to 2s. We're going to increase the 5 to 6s. Interestingly, the 3s to 4s decreased. Why is that? Behind the scenes, WISLR is deteriorating those pavements. So you had some 3 to 4 pavements that became 1 to 2 pavements because we didn't do anything to them. And your 7s to 8s increased. And why did they increase? We didn't do anything. Why did we get more 7 to 8s? Because some of our 9 to 10s fell down. We went from 31% in 9 to 10 to only about 18% 9 to 10. So those highly rated pavements have deteriorated down. They're starting to age and they're in that 7 to 8 range. The backlog shows us we put $0 into the system. We started out with almost $4.9 million in needs. After 5 years, that grew to $5.6 million. So by not doing anything, we increased our backlog over $700,000. Pretty significant, 16% increase in backlog. So by running these, you can get some good information about what the impacts are if we said, well, what if we don't do anything for 5 years? And you could run this to say, well, what if we didn't do anything this year and next year, and then we went back to our regular budget in the 3rd, 4th, and 5th year, and you could see impact on that as well. So my suggestion would be you run your base case, and that's what we did here. $500,000 a year is our base case. What we think we can continue to do without really a lot of adjustment, identifying additional revenue source, kind of a status quo. And for this agency, with the condition they have, that $500,000 budget allows them to decrease the condition 3 to 4 pavements, decrease the commission condition 5 to 6 pavements. There's a very slight decrease in 1 to 2s. Increase the condition rating of 7 to 8, but you still see the 9 to 10 is decreasing. So some of those 9 to 10s are deteriorating downward from there. you see a reduction in backlog of needs. You have, almost half of that backlog dealt with that 5-year plan at $500,000. And so compared to the do nothing, you see significant differences. You see more of the system. And so if you look at the middle graph on the 500,000 and the middle graph on the do nothing, you can see the difference between doing what we normally do and taking that money out of the budget for 5 years. If we take the money out, we're going to increase our ones to twos. We're going to increase our three to four. We're going to increase our five to six. We're going to reduce our seven to eight. And we're going to reduce our 9 to 10. So we're going to see deterioration of the condition of the pavement. And then I would compare that normal budget to the reduced budget. So this is, well, we're going to put some money in each year for the next 5 years, but we're going to cut the money in half. Rather than $500,000, we're going to use $250,000. Again, the condition before is always the same because that's the base case. That's where we're at right now with our condition. So we reported our ratings. We put them into WISLR. It knows where we're at right now condition-wise. So that's why with every one of these budgets, that condition before is going to be the same percentages. And then we do condition after plan with our base case $500,000, which you saw before. And now below that, we have in the middle on the bottom, we have the reduced case $250,000. And we'll see that it's not as noticeable a difference as when we did the do nothing budget. But with that, only that $250,000, we are seeing increase in the one to twos. We are seeing an increase comparing condition after plan normal, condition after plan reduced. The reduced, it has a higher one to two, it has a higher 3 to 4, it has a higher 5 to 6, less 7s to 8s, and less 9s to 10s. It's not as pronounced as the do nothing budget, but it still is, putting us a little further behind on the condition. We're only putting in 1.25 million over the 5 years, and we reduced the backlog by $884,000. Because again, other pavements are deteriorating. So we're putting money in, but some of that is being offset by costs associated with future needs for roads that are deteriorating over those 5 years. And then in this case, we took a slightly higher budget, another $100,000 a year, $600,000, and put that into the system and said, well, if we bump this budget up a little bit, how would that impact us? So again, the left-hand graphs for $500,000 and $600,000 are going to be the same because we're starting now at the same point. The middle graph is a projection of where we'll be at in 5 years. And so we can look at the $500,000 case in the middle on the top, the $600,000 a year case in the middle on the bottom. We'll see that by going to $600,000, we don't have any impact on the one to twos compared to the $500,000 budget, but we're taking care of more of the three to fours. We went from 7% in our base budget. We get that down to 3.8% in our $600,000 budget. We don't really have much difference in impact on the five to sixes. We don't see much change in the sevens to eights. With that additional $100,000 a year over 5 years, we do see a little bit more pavement going into the 9 to 10 range. So that extra $100,000 allowed us to take some 3 to 4 projects, reconstruct those and put them into this 9 to 10 range. And so visually you can see through comparing these graphs with these different cases, you can see the impact of your decisions on your budget. Do we keep the budget we have? Can we put some additional dollars in? What would the benefit be? If we decide to cut the budget for 1 year or 2 years because we want to save up for a big project or we need to divert some money to some other need, what would the impact of that be? You can see that projected based on statewide average deterioration curves and based on the costs that you put in or the default cost, depending on what you're using. And the PASER payment ratings you provided, you're getting a projection of where you'll be at in 5 years. So it's a pretty powerful tool. and it's relatively easy for you to use. So in this particular case, with this system being in fairly good condition to begin with, and this $500,000 budget that we currently have seeming to do a pretty good job of moving more of the system up into the 7 to 8 category, more of the system up in the 9 to 10 category. You know, you can see going from 37% to 58%, 31%, 9 to 10 to, well, that's decreasing 23%. So actually, because some of those dropped to 7 to 8, we might be satisfied with that. So maybe we'd use that as our base case. We might want to go that extra $100,000 to push these 3 to 4 numbers down further and increase our 9 to 10 numbers. But at least we can see when we're having the discussion about our 5-year plan for our pavements and our budget this year and next year for our pavements, we can see the impact of those by looking at these projections. And we saw the output before. We saw the spreadsheet output and we saw the output on the screen. This is spreadsheet output copied into here for this case study and the $500,000 budget. And so the information you were seeing in the graphs, the $500,000 budget each year for 5 years. It's a good check when you're putting those 5-year budgets in, because sometimes when you're putting a budget in, it gets, the number gets larger than the entry box. So it could be easy to put an extra zero in. This is a good spot to check to make sure the budget you put in actually matches up with what you intended. So these are all 500,000s all the way across. And it shows you how many dollars it allocated each year. And Isaac mentioned that those numbers are not going to exactly match 500,000. And you see in this case, in the fourth year, it underspent in order to have some dollars available to do a larger project in the fifth year. So it is going to, it's going to try to balance that out, but it's not going to be able to totally level that expenditure, because it can't take a project, it can't take a segment and split it in half and say, we're going to do half of this segment in order to get to $500,000. And you typically wouldn't do that either if you were putting the plan together. And so for each road, you can see the route, you can see the at and the towards, the length, the width, the surface type, pavement rating year 1, pavement rating year 5, and the action and the cost, whether it's capital or maintenance. You see the priority score that we talked about. So this was a screenshot of the first year of this plan. So our $500,000 plan for this community. And you can see the priority scores in the projects. Now the projects are displaying in this alphabetically. So you're not seeing them ordered by priority score, but you'll notice that these are all the higher priority scores. And so there, and the priority classifications, you see majors and you see minors. I believe we're also going to go to the second year of that. And you see less projects because you have some large capital projects here. These are mostly major projects, but they were in poorer condition. So you see a lot of threes and a four, no, two threes and two fours. And so we have a lot of, there's some concrete in here with some crack and seat and overlay. We have some mill and overlay and resurface projects for asphalt, higher cost projects. It prioritized these roads lower than the maintenance type projects that were in the major and minor category. And notice these are major category projects, and the priority score was lower. And so I didn't show all 5 years here, but I wanted to show at least 2 years of this to give you another example of how the system is prioritizing and what kind of output you're likely to see in WISLR when you run these 5-year plans. And so, Isaac, do you want to wrap us up here?
Yeah. So we talked about a lot. What we went over was how exactly WISLR is using our pavement ratings and projecting them over time to create a model that incorporates your data, the actual data, and lets you see what's happening to your roads over time. So again, Can't stress this enough. Your ratings need to be accurate and your ratings need to be frequent in order for the model to work. Garbage in, garbage out. We talked about the important reports, rudimentary needs analysis, how this gives you an overview of your entire road system based off of your ratings and based off of the costs that you have in your cost worksheet. And we talked about condition frequency reporting, how this is a customizable report that lets you break down the condition of your roads by their PASER ratings. And finally, we went over the five-year budget plan, the tool that takes in the entire model, your deterioration and your costs to better allocate your money into projects over 5 years. I can go on to the next slide. And finally, we mentioned this several times today, but we kind of went under the assumption that you know how to get access to the system and request your proper permissions. But this is just a refresher. You need to go to on.wisconsin.gov to create your Wisconsin web access management password and username and password. And then once you can log in using your username and password, you will need to do a couple steps to request access. So for the tools that we saw today, they are pavement rating entry update, which was our 10 o'clock session, and pavement analysis, what we covered just now. So you can actually get access to all of those at the same time in one step. And then once you process that, that'll send us an email and we will get you set up with the right authority. Next slide, please. And finally, how to contact us. You can always call us on phone. Our number is 608-266-2865. Just leave your name, your municipality, and your number in a brief description, and we will get that question routed to the right person for you. And you can also email us, whistlerinfo@dot.wi.gov. We have any questions, final questions? People are interested. I could do a short demo of one of the pavement analysis tools with our remaining 15 minutes.
Yeah, Isaac, if you want to take like maybe 10 minutes of it, I'll have to do a couple minutes of wrap up just to remind people of where to find certificates and do the evaluation. But maybe I think probably the most interest would be in the 5-year budgets or customizing the graph to allocate the ratings into different bins, different categories. I think those are probably the two that would probably generate the most interest.
Sure. Yeah, I can walk through a couple of these. And let's just see here if I'm still logged in. Okay, so I got here by going from main menu into pavement analysis. Here's our welcome screen for pavement analysis. And let's just take a look at our condition frequency report. So as you can see, we've pre-populated a pretty good split, which is just doing two ratings for each number, but we can customize that. So for example, the example we had before was 1 to 3. I think it was 4 to 4, 5 to 6, and 7 to 7. Actually, this was 1 to 2, and then this was 3 to 4. There we go. So yeah, you can put any number range you want for these, as long as the lower number is before the larger number. And then, I'm so sorry, what did I do here? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7. Technical difficulties. Might have done a bad range here. I'm very sorry. I'm not expecting this to happen. We might be having some issues with our test environment.
Isaac, if it's just running reports, and if you'd like me to, I could just log in. And I mean, I have, like, for the Shauna data and for a couple other agencies, I have access where I can, I could show their data as well. Well, there okay. It is.
So I just used the default split. So this is what the report would look like. Normally what will show up would be one bar for each series that we created. I'll have to apologize for the technical issues earlier, but I wish I could have shown you that. And then let's just take a look at our five-year budget plan. So just going back to our main menu. And I'm going to put, let's try 400,000 for each year. And if you're trying to follow along, I'm entering numbers at the bottom of the screen, five-year budget plan, budget for each year. And let's run that. It might take a bit of time. So there is a lot of complicated computation going on here. So that's why it takes a little longer than the other reports to run. And here's our report coming in. So it's almost ready. So again, we have our budget at the top and our roads at the table below, sorted alphabetically. And one thing that was a little hard to see in the slides, but I can show you well now, is how to edit this. So at the right-hand side of the road that you want to do, so let's say we want to take this street at Division Street, and we click Edit at the right-hand side. Now, this will open up every single column and row for that street. So you can see here, we have single seal coat. Now, say we wanted to do that instead of year one, let's say we wanted to do that in year two. Year two. So I'm going to put single seal code. It's going to take a little while. And what it's doing here is it's calculating how much it's going to cost you. So it knows that it's going to cost $5,805, and that's what it's defaulting. You can actually change this. So let's say that this is going to be $3,000 instead of $6,000. You can put that number there. And then we're going to want to take off our single seal coat from year one and see how it now puts a cost of $0 for year one. Now, what's going to happen when we try to save here? So if you see right now, we have $347,000 in year one and $386,000. I'm going to save this I'm going to save this forecast. So let's put a name and description. Sorry, my computer's slowing down. What's going on here? There we go. So I'm putting a name and description. There we go. And I'm going to save. So what you will see once this is done loading and saving and loading is that these numbers in our expenditures are going to change. Sorry, it's just loading here, which is why it's grayed out. So once it's no longer gray, that just means it's done updating your changes here. While it's loading, we do have some time for some questions here. So Kathy mentioned she kept getting the same error message. So we will have to take a look at that, see if there's a problem there. Scott, this is a great tool to use for planning, especially being new to the board. Thank you. So yeah, this is a test environment. You might not see these same waiting times, especially for a smaller municipality in production. We do have more resources in the full site. So, okay, let's try actually reloading our saved data here. And I think once you reload, you should see the updates to the budget.
Yeah, and when you all are working in the in your own data on the regular site, not the test site, it will run quicker than this. I just ran a report on the regular site, and it does, it will run much quicker, and I'm not getting an error message.
Okay. And yeah, and as you can see in our expenditures, it has gone down about, I think it was $3,000, and then our expenditures in year two are now up. Our division street no longer shows up in year one because we updated that to year two. So if I were to click sort by year and click year two, okay, so we actually have year two on the same here. We should see, and I thought it was Division Street that I updated. Oh, it's page number, page four, no, page three. So we should see our seal coat somewhere here. I didn't put it in year three, did I? That's a...
Well, Isaac, I'm going to wrap us up here because we only have a minute okay. left.
Yes. Sorry about that.
That's okay. There is a question in the chat, and I don't know if Shelly's still on the line because that may be a better Shelly question. When finding intersection distances, is a survey required? So, you know, if we're trying to correct or update something in certified mileage, what kind of information does a local agency need, and what quality of information to update that that centerline mileage?
Well, for new construction, we always require either a legal description or a certified survey map for any like existing roads. If you feel that they're off, you can let us know, and we'll take a look at them. Usually, we typically try to look at them in-house first. And if we feel that they're off significantly or enough to justify sending out field staff, we'll go ahead and send them out and ask them to remeasure, and they'll get us the new measurements, and we'll correct from there. That doesn't happen instantaneously. Sometimes it can take us a couple weeks, a month, maybe a little more to get field staff out. But if you find anything like that, certifications coming up, let us know.
All right. Thank you, Shelly. And just in wrapping up, I did mention, and Shelly put a link into where the functional classifications are in the system. And I'm not quite sure which one you're seeing right now. Are you seeing that, or are you seeing the course site? I got two things with green boxes around them. so I'm not sure which one you're seeing. But that functional classification information is there. If you have a question about that, now hopefully you're seeing the course site. And I will remind you that in the course materials section, you can scroll down to the bottom. You will, well, first of all, if you haven't completed quizzes, go in and complete the quizzes. If you have already done some quiz activity and you have some quiz grades, you should see the certificate of participation link under the course wrap-up and be able to download your certificate. Please, everyone, go to the course evaluation link, which is just above the course wrap-up, and click on that and give us your feedback. There's a short survey about the course. We do this training typically every other year, getting prepared for ratings in the odd numbered years, and getting your feedback will help us to improve what we do the next time we offer the course. And so we really would appreciate you taking the time to fill out that evaluation also. If anyone runs into problems either accessing the evaluation or accessing their certificate, please let me know. Although at the moment, if you haven't had any activity on quizzes at all, the certificate of participation won't have unlocked yet. You can come back into the course. We will be posting videos into the course. We will leave it open for at least 2 weeks after, and I'll probably extend that beyond so you have an opportunity to download the videos. Video is probably not going to get in until some of it may get in tomorrow. The stuff from today probably won't get in until early next week. With that, I want to thank everybody for your time, your attention, and for sticking around with us for just a minute or two extra. I'll be around for a few minutes hanging around in the course room afterwards. So if there are any one-on-one questions, we certainly can handle those as well. Thank you, everyone. Have a good rest of your day.